أنت الحبيب المصطفى، أنت الأمين، يا خير خلق الله خير المرسلين.
إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء.
الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، so inshallah we begin today with the events that are going to now lead to the Battle of Uhud. And it's a very important battle in Islam. Many people, they realize the importance of Badr, but there's a lot of hikam, a lot of wisdoms in Uhud many people don't realize. So we were in the seerah where Ka'b ibn Ashraf, the Yahudi who was causing fitan, who had declared a war against Allah and his Prophet, had betrayed his treaties, had been killed by the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Now after that, if we look at the authentic books, looking at the takhrij of ahadith, there are some events that have weak narration. So we're going to leave those out. Focusing on the authentically preserved part of the seerah, as Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyah mentioned in Zad al-Ma'ad, Ibn Hisham quotes from Ibn Ishaq with the authentic sanad, there was a tribe that again collected against the Prophet ﷺ. Some of the ulama of tariq felt this was a caravan, but the more authentic narrations point towards there was another threat towards Medina. And here, Rasulullah ﷺ himself set out again. And this shows how brave the Prophet ﷺ was. It wasn't that he just sent the Sahaba or sent some people. Like you look at many of the leaders today, they just send somebody else. You don't see, you know, leaders of countries putting on uniforms and taking up guns and going and battling themselves. And that's why it's so easy for them to start battles and let people get killed, because they're sitting in their palaces, they're sitting in their luxuries, not feeling what the people are feeling. But the Prophet ﷺ, he took 300 of the Sahaba, 300 Mujahideen, and he himself put on the clothes for war, and he went out. And this is called Ghazwa Bahran. Ghazwa Bahran is the name given to this battle. When the Prophet ﷺ went out, the kuffar, they ran away. Once again, these are people who wanted to do a surprise attack. Like we saw earlier, these are not people who really believe in their cause, who are willing to die for what they believe in. They just wanted to do a surprise attack and harm the Muslims and to make themselves look good or get the ghanima. This is all they were interested in. So by the time the Prophet ﷺ went out, they ran away. There was no ghanima, there was no fight, there was nothing. But the Prophet ﷺ, as Ibn Kathir has mentioned with the Sahih Sanad, the Prophet ﷺ, he stayed there for 2 months. Between a month and a half to 2 months. And even with 300 people, it's very difficult feeding them, keeping them. But the Prophet ﷺ wanted to show an example. And this is an example to the Day of Judgment for us to see the way the mushrikeen of Quraysh were attacking and killing and running away in the nights, and how the Prophet ﷺ, as shuja', as being brave, and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they would stay at a place. It wasn't a hit and run. They would stay and show that they are there without any fear, even when there's no fight. So here the Prophet ﷺ, he went and he stayed there 2 months and he came back, and this is al-Ghazwa. Why we call it Ghazwa? Because this is where the Prophet ﷺ himself went out. Now, back when we were looking at the issue of the Quraysh, they have been defeated in Badr. And if you look on a map, Mecca and Sham have Medina in the middle. So the people of Quraysh, their trade used to be to two places. In the summer, they would go out to Sham. And in the winter, towards Yemen. And that's the two places, the two major centers of trade. And the people of Mecca, the Quraysh, had no other real means of income except trade. Yani they would make something of people coming for tawaf and things, and the people would bring some trade to them, but their main financial institute wasn't farming. They didn't produce anything, but their main resource for wealth was trade. So now the Quraysh were worried because they had attacked Medina, as we discussed in the last dars, and they had killed Sahaba, and they had killed people who were just farmers. They had attacked in such a cowardly way. Abu Sufyan, when he came with the people from Mecca and he attacked an outside village outside of Medina, and two unarmed Sahaba from the Ansar, who were farmers, not armed, not soldiers, with all his wealth and his might and his army, they just attacked them and killed them and burnt their farms and ran so fast in the night that even dropped their supplies. So now they had attacked and killed again after Badr. So this was an open state of war. So they realized that if their caravan goes past Medina, because it's a war, the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba will attack them. So they started to make shura, they started to discuss. One mushrik, he gave them an idea. He told them, you know what you should do is go a different route. And what you should do is go all the way up to Iraq and then turn from Iraq towards the west and go to Sham. Now, if you look at a map, if you visualize a map, it's a very long way. A direct path from Mecca would be past Medina, go north and hit Sham. But this way, you have to go east, west, and east, northeast towards Iraq first, and then west to Sham. So you do like a number 7 around Medina to get away from Medina. But they decided that they will do this. So the Quraysh, they gathered a lot of their wealth. And we'll discuss how much the ulama of Tarif have discussed later. But it was a great amount. And a lot of Abu Sufyan's personal wealth was involved in this. And they put it together, and they kept this a secret from even the rest of Quraysh. Only the leaders and those that were involved knew about it. Because they knew that there are people in Mecca that in their hearts were Muslims. Even if they were not sure who, but they knew there were people like that. And we know one of them is Abbas radiallahu anhu, who is a Sahabi in his heart. He's a Muslim, but he's still in Mecca as an intelligence gathering source for the Prophet ﷺ. So knowing this, they kept it a secret. But the Quraysh now had a problem. And what was their problem? They knew the ways from Mecca passing Medina to Sham very easily. But they didn't know how to go to Iraq and then Sham. I mean, nowadays, you think we're going to Google it or MapQuest or you know, look for the signs. But at that time, it's all desert. And if you get lost, you're dead. Because, you know, it's not like you can stop at a gas station and pick up some drinks. Over there, you have to go from water source to water source or you would die of thirst. There were storms, there were bandits. So they didn't know the way. So a mushrik, he came up with the idea to go to a tribe called Banu Bakr bin Wa'il. Banu Bakr bin Wa'il, this tribe, they knew this path. And they were mushrikeen as well. And they hired a man named Furat ibn Hayyan. Furat ibn Hayyan was a mushrik from the tribe of Bakr bin Wa'il, as Ibn al-Qayyim has mentioned with authentic asanid. And they paid him to be their guide. So with this guide, in secret, they're about to set out. But there is a man who's involved in putting this together. His name is Nu'aym ibn Mas'ud al-Ashja'i. Nu'aym ibn Mas'ud al-Ashja'i. And he is at this time a mushrik, even though according to the majority of the ulama, later he becomes a Muslim as well. We're looking at history. There were times when somebody wasn't Muslim and then they made tawbah, they turned back to Allah and they become Muslims. But here he is a mushrik and he knows about this plan, but he keeps it a secret. And he has a drinking buddy. A drinking buddy, somebody he drinks with. And his name is Salib. Salib, radiallahu anhu, is a Muslim. Salib ibn Nu'man. He is a Muslim in secret. Now a question can come, how can a Muslim be drinking? Well, we know this is the earlier time when the ahkam forbidding alcohol have not been revealed. And that means there is no dham, there is no sin upon them. There is no itham here. Why? Because all the ahkam came in stages. As we know, the hukum of salah, the hukum of Ramadan, of fasting Ramadan, the hukum of giving zakah as fard, the hukum of going for hajj, The hukam, all these ahkam, they came in stages. So if you look at a practice at an earlier stage, you cannot make it a dalil for a later stage. And you cannot use it as an itham for somebody who did it. Even though we know there were some of the Sahaba that never drank, as has been authentically reported from Abu Bakr and Uthman radiallahu anhuma, that they never drank even in the Jahiliyyah. Because they found it something to be disgraceful, even from their own fitrah. And you will find, even among non-Muslims today, you will find some people that don't drink alcohol, because they see the evils of it. But those Sahaba that did in the earlier time, before it was haram, there is no sin upon them. So this Sahabi, Salib ibn Nu'man, he is sitting with Nu'aym ibn Mas'ud and they're drinking. And one of the evils that you find in drinking is when somebody gets drunk, they have no control over their mouth and other bodily functions. So he gets drunk and Nu'aym ibn Mas'ud, he tells him the whole story. How much wealth and which way, and he tells him everything. Now Salib radiallahu anhu, he's a hidden Muslim at this time anyway, his Islam is in secret. So Nu'aym doesn't think about it. But Salih radiallahu anhu, when he gets this information, he rides quickly to Medina and he tells the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As it's mentioned that it would take between 7 to 8 days for a caravan to go from Mecca to Medina. But some of these, like Salih radiallahu anhu, in 3 days he made it to Medina, secretly. And he gave the news to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he came back to Mecca without the people of Mecca knowing. Because Islam was in secret anyway, so they didn't notice him going and coming. But now the Prophet ﷺ, he has this news, and he chooses somebody beloved to him and to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He chooses Zayd bin al-Haritha radiallahu anhu. Subhanallah, I thought of something beautiful about this. Look at how much Rasulullah ﷺ loved Zayd ibn Haritha. And Usama, the son of Zayd, Usama bin Zayd, that many times we find in Seerah Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he puts them in charge. And Zayd bin Haritha is a freed slave. Yani he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a slave, but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he freed him and honored him so much that he puts him in charge of the armies. As we'll study later, that Usama bin Zayd, the son of Zayd radiallahu anhu, he's the son of a slave who's been freed. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would make him an amir on a jaysh, on an army, when he's only 17 years old, and this army will have Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and many of the great Sahaba. So you look at the honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives through Islam. Another point about Zayd bin Haritha radiallahu anhu. You know, there's only one Sahabi clearly mentioned by name in the Quran. You know who he is, obviously, because we're discussing him. Zayd radiallahu anhu. But did you ever think about this? If you recite this name with the niyyah of reciting the Quran, not when you just say, you know, Zayd al-Uthman, or you just take a name, but when you do it with the niyyah of reciting the Quran, just for saying the word Zayd, you get 30 rewards. Subhanallah, what a blessed name. Because we know from the Sahih Hadith, when you recite the Quran to every harf, you get 10 rewards. So, za, ya, dal, 3 huruf. You just say Zayd, with the niyyah of reciting Quran, you get 30 rewards. What a beautiful name it is. And he was so beloved to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his kalam, in his words, mentioned him in the Quran. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he took Zayd bin Haritha radiallahu anhu, and as Ibn Ishaq and others have mentioned with the Sahih As-Sa'anid, he gave him 100 mujahideen, 100 from the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. And he told him to go out fast in stealth mode and go and capture this caravan. Now, one of the benefits that one of my teachers in his Durus on Sirah mentioned is this wealth was being used to fund activities against the Muslims as well. Because right after Badr, the mushrikeen of Quraysh started to prepare their next attack on the Muslims. After Badr, it wasn't like they quit. They started to prepare their next attack on the Muslims. And this is how they would make money. They would do this trade, and the profits they would get, they would use it against the Muslims. So here, to stop this, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he sent Zayd bin Haritha with 100 mujahideen. The Quraysh, their caravan was headed by Safwan bin Umayyah, the one whose father, Umayyah bin Khalaf, was killed in Badr, and his brother was killed in Badr. So he was somebody with a great hatred for Islam to begin with, so he was more than happy to take this caravan. Zayd bin Haritha radiallahu anhu, he caught up to them in a watering place called Qarada. Qarada was a place where they would have water. So before the caravan could get there, Zayd bin Haritha radiallahu anhu got there, and they attacked the caravan, and without any fighting, Safwan ibn Umayyah and the people he was with, they ran away. Subhanallah. Again, you see, no real dedication to their cause. Even though they had all this wealth of the Quraysh, and they were so dedicated, and they had this zeal against Islam, but they ran away. And here, the Furat, the Ibn Hayyan, the one from Bani Bakr, Ibn Wa'il, their guide, him and two other men, they were captured by the Sahaba. And they were treated kindly. Subhanallah, look at the akhlaq of Islam. When we talk about history, we put this challenge out, even to non-Muslims watching this video. Look at how beautifully the prisoners were treated by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then bring me any example from the Romans, from the Greek, from the Persian, from anybody from the non-Muslim empires, and show me historically how they treated their prisoners. Even till today. Here, Furat, he was treated so well that when he was brought back to Medina, our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave him da'wah and he became a Muslim. Subhanallah, without any power, without any force, he became a Muslim himself. And he was allowed to leave. No fidya, nothing. No harm, no torture, nothing. And he went back and gave da'wah to his tribe. So here, you look at the makr, or the planning of the kuffar, and the makr of Allah, the planning of Allah. They are getting these people from these other tribes to use against Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using them to become Muslim and become du'at. Become the people who are giving da'wah towards Islam. Here, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they got a great ghanima as well. This wealth that was being taken to fund hostilities, aggression against the Muslims, was taken by the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Not there was gold and there was silver and there was different amounts. But if you look at the tabaqat of Ibn Sa'd and Ibn Kathir and Ibn Ishaq and other ulama and their books, all of them have come to a conclusion that it was worth 100,000 dirham. 100,000 dirham, that means it was a great amount of wealth. And it was a great victory for the believers. But it was a great setback for the Quraysh, because they were counting on that money to fund their war against the Muslims. And Abu Sufyan, a lot of his own wealth was here. And the leaders of Quraysh, they were expecting great rewards. As some of the ulama said, that their profit would be 1 to 1. For every dirham, they would make another dirham. So they were expecting 200,000 dirhams to come back, and they lost everything. So here, it was too much for them. Because the kuffar, they love money. When you hit them in the wallet, that's what really hurts. And when the Quraysh got hit in their wallet here, they became extremely angry. And they stepped up their efforts against Islam. And what did they do? They sent out their best poets and their most eloquent speakers. And they went out to all of the tribes of the Arab and started to collect from them. Now here, subhanallah, they have three options. If you look at the Quraysh, they have three options. One, they could become Muslims themselves. They have seen miracles. They saw miracles in Badr. They saw Malaika. They saw the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here they have an option, accept the truth and there will be peace. The second option, they could make sulh. They could make a treaty. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was always open to bringing peace. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to Medina, what is the first thing he did? He brought peace. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he met the Jews, the tribes of the Yahud in Medina, what did he do? He made a treaty. He made peace. And he kept his treaties. And the Prophet ﷺ did not start any aggression against the people of Mecca until the people of Mecca continually attacked and harmed and killed Muslims. So the Prophet ﷺ is open to peace, and the Quraysh have this option, but they don't take it. They take the third option, which is to step up their attack on Medina. And they go out to the different tribes, and they collect money, and they go to those people who had benefited from the wealth that came in Badr. Yani in Badr, even though they lost, but Abu Sufyan, he took the wealth of Mecca, the caravan, and escaped. So that wealth that came into Mecca, they went to those people and said, your wealth was saved, but your people were killed. Now dedicate this wealth to fighting Islam. So they took that wealth, and they went to the different Arab tribes and fundraised. And one of the people is Abu al-Azza. Abu al-Azza was the poet we discussed earlier. After Badr, he was captured. But the Prophet ﷺ, out of his mercy, he left him. But instead of accepting that kindness and returning it with some good akhlaq, he turned back and he worked against Islam. And subhanAllah, he is the only one that will be captured after Uhud. When we talk about the prisoners of Uhud, we'll talk about him. That he will be captured from the mushrikeen. And this time the Prophet ﷺ will not let the believer be bit from the same hole twice. We'll talk about that in the end of Uhud, inshaAllah. So Abu al-Azza, Amr ibn al-As, Abu Sufyan, they go out to the different areas and they start collecting money against Islam, against the Muslims. And when we look at how much they gather, it's a great amount. According to Mubarak Puri, they had 3,000 fighters, 1,000 camels, and 200 horses. But when I was looking at some of the different books, like Ibn Ishaq and Zaad al-Ma'ad of Nilqayyim, and Had al-Habib of Sheikh Abu Bakr al-Jazairi, and Al-Mukhtasar al-Sira of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, and Sira al-Nabawiyya al-Sahiyya of Dr. Akram al-Amri, we find some different numbers. What we know from clear and Sahih Asani, and Abu Ishaq, who was a very early scholar of Tariq, he has mentioned with Sahih Asani from his teachers, going back to the Sahaba, that the Quraysh were 3,000. So no doubt that they had 3,000 fighters of Quraysh. And they had two other Arab tribes that joined them. Banu Kinana, which is a very strong and big tribe, and Ahlul Thimama. Ahlul Thimama were another tribe that also joined the Quraysh. And we know through authentic chains that they had 200 horses. And this is a lot. At that time, a horse was like a tank today. They were fast, they were better at war than camels. So 200 horses was a huge amount. And according to the majority of the ulama of Tariq, that they had 3,000 camels. And Mubarak Puri mentioned 1,000. But the earlier books, they all mentioned 3,000. And they had 50,000 dinar, not dirham, but dinar, which is more. 50,000 dinar collected. This means that they had a very strong army. Ibn Hisham and others have mentioned that they had 700 fully armored soldiers. Yani 3,000 fighters, but 700 that had full body armor. And these were very difficult to fight, because their armor protected every vital organ. So if you attacked them, it was very difficult to get in and get to anything that would drop them. And they're not going to just stand there. They'll be attacking you at that time. So it's very difficult to take them down. Very few of the Muslims even had full body armor. Even the ones that had armor was not full. So 3,000 Quraysh fighters, two additional tribes with them, 200 horses, 3,000 camels, 50,000 dinar, and 700 of the 3,000 fully armored soldiers. And they head out against Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now some of the ulama mentioned, like Ibn Ishaq, that 8 women went with them. Other ulama, like Al-Waqidi, he mentioned 14, but he's matruk, he's weak in hadith. Other ulama, they said 15. But we do know that Quraysh took women with them. Now why? Why would you take women out to a battle? Because there are some benefit the Quraysh they decided to get from this. One, these women were all poets. They would recite poetry to entice their men to fight. Secondly, many of them were relatives. They were wives or daughters of those that are fighting, so they would fight harder to defend them. And third, their job was to stand behind the lines. So if the men start running, they would spit in their faces, they would slap them, they would try to give them honor to go back and fight. So they took even their women with them. At this time, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is in Medina, he has no idea about this. But Abbas radiallahu anhu, the great Sahabi, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he writes a letter and he sends it with a man of Banu Ghaffar, the tribe Banu Ghaffar. Because they were fast riders, they were bandits. So he paid this man to go from Mecca in 3 days, quickly, to Medina and get the news to the Prophet ﷺ. So this man, he takes this news, he gets to Medina, he asks, where is the Prophet ﷺ? Our beloved Prophet ﷺ, he was in Masjid Quba. In Masjid Quba, this rider, he gets to Masjid Quba, he gives the letter to Rasulullah ﷺ. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's unlettered, he can't read. So he has one of the Sahaba read it to him. The Sahabi, he reads it to him. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells him, keep this a secret between us. Now look at the hikmah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the wisdoms. You know, if the news spreads that 3,000 soldiers and 700 armed men with 3,000 camels and 200 horses and all of 50,000 dinars are coming, it puts the panic. But the Prophet ﷺ, he does everything organized. And this is a very important lesson for us. When you're patient, it doesn't mean you're a coward. It doesn't mean that you're scared. It means that you know how to do things at the right time. And this is a problem in our ummah today. We don't understand how to deal with what problem at what time, because of a lack of leadership. So here the Prophet ﷺ, he takes this news, he goes back to Masjid Nabawi. And he collects the leaders, the great believers from the Ansar and the Muhajireen. And he sits down with them and he lays the news out to them. Now the Muhajireen, obviously they are ready. They are there, they're ready. But the Ansar, the Prophet ﷺ really wanted to hear from them. The same thing we saw in Badr. And subhanAllah, the Ansar were the most zealous and ready. Sa'd ibn Mu'adh radiallahu anhu. He has great poetries that he wrote here, telling the Prophet ﷺ that there is khair in this. That this battle that's coming, there is khair in this, and we are ready. And the leaders of the Ansar, all of them, they were ready with the Prophet ﷺ. Now on the other hand, Abu Sufyan is the leader of the army. The general leader is Abu Sufyan. Khalid bin Walid and Ikrama ibn Abi Jahl, they are leading the 200 horsemen. They are leading the cavalry. And they're heading towards Medina. Here Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, realizing that this is coming, and now he comes and he brings the Sahaba together. And at this moment, it's a very dangerous moment, because the time is passing and the army is coming closer. Until the mushrikeen of Quraysh had reached a place called Ainain. And this is close to the mountain of Uhud. And we talk about Uhud, it's very important for us to go and see this place. Because many times we don't understand a hadith or seerah because we haven't seen it. When we talk about a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam talks about giving to the mountain of Uhud, or giving so much gold, like in the Sahih Hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if I had gold to the amount of the Mount of Uhud, I wouldn't want 3 nights to go by except that I've given it all out in sadaqah. But when we don't realize how big Uhud is, then we don't really understand this hadith. When we talk about the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is that don't talk ill about my sahaba. Because if you were to give the amount of gold in Uhud in sadaqah, you would not meet their good deeds. We don't realize what this hadith means until we see Uhud. So when we go for Hajj and Umrah, especially when you're in Medina, you will see it. You can't miss Uhud. It's big, it's huge. And when you see it, you realize what these ahadith mean and what the seerah was telling us. So here, Abu Sufyan with the Quraysh, they are in a place called Ainain, getting to Uhud, next to Uhud, outside of Medina. Today, it's inside of Medina. So, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he brings the Sahaba radiallahu anhum together, and he discusses what to do. And the first thing he does, and look at the great wisdom of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in war. He does three things even before the battle. He makes three units amongst the Sahaba. One that is told to go and be on guard and patrol outside of Medina. They are on horses, they're fast, they're outside of Medina, a small group, making sure there's no surprise attacks coming in. A second, to guard the entrances to the streets of Medina, so that if somebody attacks, they will be there to stop them at this moment and allow the Sahaba enough time to come. And a third, to stand in protection of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the major Sahaba radiallahu anhu. And this is very important. Today, we don't understand hikmah. Like today we think tawakkul means you don't use the asbab. But this is not tawakkul. Tawakkul is you tie your camel, as mentioned in the other hadith, and then you put your tawakkul in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't mean you take a stake and you go in battle and you poke somebody with a stake. No. You prepare yourself. And then even if you're light, even if you're not heavy in preparation, you still put your tawakkul, but you prepare. Many of the people, today they have this incorrect understanding. Don't get a job. Sit in the masjid, make dhikr, Allah will bring you rizq. This is not what the Prophet ﷺ taught us. Can Allah bring the rizq? Of course, Allah can do everything. But go ahead and don't get married, expect a child, see what happens. Can Allah do it? Of course. But this is the thing. People don't want to study Sharia, they don't want to study, they want to become muftis. I was giving a khutbah recently somewhere, I was sitting with some brothers afterwards, and we were talking, and one brother, mashallah, everything he had a fatwa. And all of what he was saying was wrong. About Qiyam al-Layl on the night of New Year's Eve. SubhanAllah, what are you talking about? New Year's Eve? It's not even Islamic New Year. And even if you take the Islamic New Year, there is no ibadah that is proven from the Prophet ﷺ on the night before the first of Muharram. And he's talking about this program and this, and ya'ni, this is okay, and ya'ni, this is wrong. And just because his mother tongue was Arabic, he thought he was a Mufti. And when I started talking to him, he started getting upset. You know? When you ask him, Akhi, is there a hadith? Yani, some of the ulema. Which ulema? Yani, this one alim, I said, what's his name? Which ayah of Quran, what hadith? SubhanAllah. You have to use the asbab, sit with ulema, study, then you will learn. You have to use the asbab. Here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though we know, like Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu, later we was ready in the seerah for his life, that he would sleep without guards. But the Sahaba, they would go out to guard. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam doesn't need a guard. In Mecca, who protected him when his house was surrounded? It was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he's showing the ummah a way. So here, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he already puts this method out. And here, it's a very difficult time in Medina. And I want to talk about this. Because we don't realize what it was like for the Sahaba radiallahu anhum at this time. The Sahaba at this time, they were under a lot of stress. Because the attack wasn't like bombs and you know, loud planes. No, it was quiet. When you would hear it, it would be upon you. So they know now that 3,000 men, 3,000 camels, 200 horses, 50,000 dinar, everything is ready to attack Medina. And they're sitting in Medina at night. And they're waiting. And it's a very stressful time. Imagine what our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, our beloved Ashab, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, radiallahu anhu, what they went through. And at this stressful time, they would still come to the masjid for salah. They would still make salah in jama'ah. And they would come armed. And today, subhanAllah, I mean, before I say this, disclaimer, please follow the laws of your country, whichever country you live in, and you know, don't use any kind of weaponry in any way that we're not promoting anything like that. But today we think if somebody arms themselves, they don't have tawakkul. Like if you see an alim in a place where there is danger, with a weapon, people think, oh, look at this Mawlana sahab, what's he doing with the weapon? This, subhanAllah. This is not the way of the Sahaba. The Sahaba, they would come to the masjid armed. And their women would be at home, so imagine the stress. Knowing that an attack can come. And they would say that we have the fear of the enemy, but the fear of Allah is greater. And they would come for Salah and Jama'ah. And they would come, and they would make Salah under stress. But they would still make their Salah with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he called the Shura as well. And there's a great benefit in what we're going to discuss. Because Uhud, as we're going to discuss, there's a lot of ups and downs in Uhud. And many people don't see the benefits of Uhud, but there's a lot. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have brought down wahi. A hukm could have been brought, what to do. Or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could have just made a decision and the Sahaba would follow him. But instead, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called for a shura and asked for opinions. Why? It's a very important point. If an ayah came about every battle and every decision, and if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made every decision from his own hukam without shura, what would happen to the ummah after the passing away of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What would happen to the ummah when the wahi stops? When the Quran is complete? The next time a decision needed to be made, the ummah would not know how to make a decision. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam an example for us. So here, no ayat will reveal what to do yet. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't just make an opinion and said, this is my decision. Instead, he called the Sahaba and he asked their opinions. And he gave his own opinion without making a decision. He is the one who makes the decision. But first, he gave an opinion. And he said, my opinion is that we stay within Medina. We stay in Medina and we guard the path of Medina. And there is some fawaid here. One, the Quraysh, it has 3,000 people. An army that large to sustain every day feeding them and keeping them is difficult on them. So they will have a difficult time sustaining outside. So it will put them under stress. Secondly, when they attack Medina, they will not be able to attack with their whole army because they have to go through tight streets. So the battle will be only between those people that fit in the front of that street and those that stand in front of them. Because the Sahaba are few and the Quraysh are many. And the third benefit, even the women of the believers, they can get on top of the houses and they can throw rocks and throw things and benefit the Muslim armies. And this is the way of battle. If you've ever been to Masjid Al-Aqsa in Al-Quds, if you go today, it's very hard to get there. When you get there, you can't. It's not like a straight shot like Mecca or Medina where you see it from far and you just go straight. You have to go into the old city. And when you go in, there's these little paths that turn and twist and have little shops nowadays. Until you suddenly get in front of it. When I went there, it was very difficult. You had to ask how to go there, even when you got right close to it. And when I asked about this, the ulama there, they explained that this was done in the time of Salahuddin Ayyubi. And he set it up in such a way so crusaders and kuffar couldn't directly attack the Muslims. That they would have to go through these paths and they would be attacked from the rooftops. And it's a very intelligent way in war. Now one of the people, the munafiq, Abdullah ibn Ubay, we talked about him earlier. He gives the same opinion but for a different reason. SubhanAllah. Now, another wisdom here. Why would the Prophet ﷺ have Abdullah ibn Ubay sitting in the shura? And many of our brothers don't understand wisdom, especially the youth. The Prophet ﷺ is very wise. He wants to keep this munafiq close to him to know what he's thinking. And even though the Prophet ﷺ will clearly mention later that he's a munafiq and will be careful of his tricks, but he knows and he keeps him close. Especially because he's one of the chiefs of Al-Khazraj, of the tribe of Khazraj. And openly he's become a Muslim. So here, he gives the same opinion, but for a different reason. And the reason, as mentioned by himself in later narrations, bragging to other munafiqun, is because he said, if we're in Medina, if we get attacked, we can hide and not have to fight. So subhanAllah, sometimes, even if it's a good opinion, the niyyah is what matters, the intention. But here, many of the youth from amongst the Sahaba, radiallahu anhum, they give a different opinion. They give the opinion, they said, "Oh, Messenger of Allah," and again, this is with all due respect, because here the Prophet ﷺ is asking for opinion. If he makes a decision, his decision is it. But when he asks an opinion, you should give an opinion. And we should learn this for our ummah, how to make decisions through using the shura, through having a faisal, somebody who makes a decision, through asking opinions, and giving your opinion with ikhlas and good niyyah. So here, these young sahaba with their ikhlas, they give the opinion, they say, "Oh, Messenger of Allah, what if we stay in Medina and the Quraysh, they go back, and we don't get the opportunity to become shuhada?" Subhanallah, look at their zeal. They want to become shuhada, they're saying, "We want to become shuhada." What will the people say, that we were afraid of them? Wallahi, we love Allah and His religion and His Messenger more than life. We want to become shuhada, we want to go out and meet them in the battlefield. And one of the people who gave this opinion, as mentioned in the Sahih Hadith, was Hamza. Hamza, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, radiallahu anhu. Hamza, the Lion of Allah. Hamza, the great Sahabi. He gives the same opinion. In some of the narrations, and these are Sahih Asanid, he says, "Wallahi, I make a qasam that I'm not going to eat food until I meet them with my sword in the battlefield." And many of the Sahaba, they said, "Wallahi, we're not close to our spouses, to our wives, until we meet the enemy out in the battlefield with our swords." These were men. These were rijal. So they went out with this opinion. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he accepted their opinion. And there's a lot of benefits of why. And here, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on the 6th of Shawwal, on a Jum'ah, in the 3rd year of Hijri, he gives the khutbah. And imagine how beautiful of a khutbah it must have been. With our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wearing a black amam, standing on the minbar with a sword in his hand, giving a khutbah, giving targhib toward going out fi sabilillah, and talking about sacrifice and sabr. And if you look at the khutbah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will find always he would call towards taqwa. But this khutbah is particularly, he called towards sacrifice and sabr and patience. And you will see the wisdom of that later in Uhud. And after that beautiful khutbah, with the beautiful sahaba and iman in their hearts, the Prophet ﷺ, with Abu Bakr and Umar and Ali ibn Abi Talib, the great sahabi, and Hamza radiallahu anhum, may Allah be pleased with all of them, they went and put on their gear for war. And in the books of Shumail, and in the books that describe the Prophet ﷺ, when they talked about what did the Prophet ﷺ wear when he gave the khutbah, when he gave the khutbah, he would wear the amam. And the majority of the hadith for the khutbah is a black amam. And you will find it also on the day of Fath al-Makkah. Although there are other colors, like the white that was put on the head of Abdurrahman bin Auf radiyallahu, or a yellowish color, called a qitri color, that we can discuss in my book on imama. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he loved the black imam. And he put on his armor. And when I was reading the description about the clothes of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and as I was listening to some of the ulama and what they wrote, we see that there was a close, loose garment. Many of the thiyab we see today, they're very tight. You can barely run in them, let alone fight in them. But the clothes that we see that are loose, that you can able to move, these were the clothes that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wore. And he put on two pieces of armor, two chest plates. And this is also to show the ummah that there's nothing wrong with arming and using the asbab. It's not against tawakkul. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with his sword in his neck, and the sahaba with him, and his amama, and his armor, he set out towards the mountain of Uhud to face Abu Jahl. And what will happen, inshallah, we will study in the next dars, next Saturday, inshallah ta'ala.